things are about to get very interesting. When we apply tensor algebra to the computer scientist's single qubit state space C2, we unlock all the tools and tricks needed for basic quantum algorithm design. Today, we enter the strange world of non-locality, the preparation of two separate qubits whose quantum states are inextricably bound by the marriage of quantum entanglement. Inextricably, that is, until we take a measurement, at which point, divorce. I suppose that the last chapter spoiled the surprise. The state space that models a two-qubit system is the tensor product H times H. We'll designate it as H2, the second-order tensor product. Caution, that 2 does not indicate the dimension, which is actually 4. It's the order, the number of copies of H that we're multiplying together. Everything falls into place exactly as predicted. The new four-dimensional preferred basis consists of the four separable products of the two-component Z bases. And we introduce some very useful alternate terminology for those four vectors. If we start off with alternate bases in our individual H spaces, we'll end up with an alternate tensor basis. For example, the two-dimensional X basis will induce a four-dimensional X basis on H2. We'll also analyze three or four binary logic gates in painstaking detail so that you'll be able to reproduce the steps for any future multi-qubit gate. There will be five aspects of every gate I want you to understand. Three of them are just different and equivalent ways to define the gate. How the gate acts on the four CBS kets, the matrix for the gate, and the effect the gate has on an arbitrary state in the space. As you read through the chapter, you'll be cautioned that a general state going into or coming out of a binary operator might not be separable. In that case, we can't really show two individual qubits being sent in or coming out. But if it happens that there is a separable state on either side, we'll show the individual qubits, where there's an implied tensor product sign between the two. And often, we have a separable state going in, but a non-separable one coming out. In fact, that last situation comes up in the first huge application of quantum gates, namely the production of entangled pairs. An entangled state is a second-order tensor, sometimes called a bipartite state, that happens to be non-separable. That's all there is to it mathematically. If the tensor is non-separable, it represents an entangled state. You can see this clearly when we feed a certain gate two particular qubits, ket 0 of the preferred basis going into the A register, and ket 0 of the X basis going into the B register. The output is an entangled bipartite state, because there's no way you can express it as a simple product of two tensors. Try it. And to help you become accustomed to the common vernacular, we'll say ket 0 and ket 1 when we mean the preferred basis vectors, and ket plus and ket minus when we mean the X basis vectors. In that language, we're feeding the gate ket 0 up top and ket plus down below. I'll walk you through the process of analyzing bipartite operations with two widely used gates, first the CNOT, then the second-order Hadamard. A clutch application of binary quantum gates is their use in measuring a state along an alternate basis. We'll review and expand the connection between expanding a ket along some basis and measuring its corresponding state with respect to that basis. We'll also see what that means if the basis is separable, like the X basis, or non-separable, like the Bell basis. There's a technique that'll turn up again and again in our algorithms. It's based on a quantum phenomenon called the Born rule. Stated simplistically, the Born rule tells us that when one qubit of an entangled pair is measured, it forces the collapse of the other qubit. In preparation for our first quantum algorithms coming up next lecture, I'll expose you to a few small circuits, including one that uses more than two qubits. This chapter is long. There's no getting around that fact. But, to be fair, we're repeating the same analysis for four or five different binary gates. And after you've seen those moves on one, reading the others will be a little easier. So, take your time, refer to the table of optional paths to keep your reading relevant to your background, and set aside two or three different days in which to inhale this heady vapor of fully caffeinated quantum computing. Once mastered, you'll be ready for your first quantum algorithms next week.